So, a few months ago, Derek, on his popular YouTube channel, More Plates, More Dates, released a video where he outlined his reasoning as to why he was starting to take a semi-novel class of ecdysteroids known as turkesterone. Then, a couple of months after he released this video and launched a product by the same name, Andrew Huberman, one of the leading figures in the space of men's health, also mentioned it when he was on the Joe Rogan Experience. And ever since that podcast was released, ecdysteroids have been exploding in popularity like I have never seen before. Now, with a health trend like this, there usually is some level of truth behind the claims that are being made, followed by a ton of hype that is surrounding these legitimate health claims. And so essentially what I want to do in this video is walk through all of the most relevant research on ecdysteroids, so that we can essentially parse through and decide what is fact and what's fiction. And so without further ado, let's go ahead and dive right in. Now, ecdysteroids are a class of phytochemicals that are used by plants to defend themselves against insects. However, from what little research we currently have, they also appear to be biologically active in animals and probably humans as well. Now, there is currently over 400 identified ecdysteroids, but the most relevant class of ecdysteroids seem to be beta-ecdysterone, 20-hydroxyectazone, and turkesterone, the latter appearing to be the most anabolic. Now, there does appear to be some slight differences in how these ecdysteroids are processed and metabolized within the body. However, they do appear to be minor, and so for the sake of our conversation today, we're going to kind of lump all of the research together and kind of just look at it as one. Now, I've been doing research and personal experimentation with ecdysteroids for the past several months now, and let me just go ahead and say this. The research is an absolute mess. A ton of the research is in Russian currently, and this prevents you from essentially accessing all of the dosing protocols and the experimental design. And the research that's in English, a lot of it is behind various research paywalls, which similarly prevents you from accessing all of the dosing and experimental designs as well. And so because of this, it is extremely difficult to draw any definitive conclusions at this moment. However, there is some relevant research that I want to dive into. And so let's go ahead and dive into it. Now, the first category of research that we're going to be looking at today is in vitro research. And this is essentially research that is exclusively performed in cell cultures, essentially inside of a petri dish. But the first paper that we're going to look at today is this one, where the researchers concluded that, and I quote, in C2, C12 murine myotubes and human primary myotubes, phytoecdysteroids increased protein synthesis by up to 20%. Now, myotubes are one of the foundational structures of muscle tissue. And in this study in particular, they found that ecdysteroids increased muscle protein synthesis and muscle growth in particular by up to 20%, which is pretty promising. Now, in this study as well, the researchers concluded that in this study, we show that in a mouse skeletal muscle cell line C2, C12, 12-hydroxyectazone, a common phytoecdysteroid, in both insects and plants, elicited a rapid elevation in intracellular calcium followed by sustained AKT activation and increased protein synthesis. And in this study, the researchers later on in this paper noted a very similar increase in muscle protein synthesis by up to 16%, which again is super promising. Now, one of the important things to note here is that almost all of the in vitro research at this point that has been performed shows very consistent increases in muscle protein synthesis as well as muscle growth, which suggests that if ecdysteroids do get to relevant tissues, including muscle tissue, that there is some type of reliable growth that ensues. Now, this is all extremely promising, but the most relevant question that we have to ask here is, do we see the same results in living models? And so the first study that I want to go to dive into this question is this one, where the researchers concluded that, and I quote, according to our results, 20-hydroxyectazone may provide an alternative for substitution of anabolic androgenic steroids in therapeutic treatment against muscle atrophy. Now, again, this is super promising. However, it is worth noting that the dosage and magnitude of effect was not listed in the abstract, so it's extremely difficult to draw any definitive conclusions here. Now, the most common reference study in regards to the animal research on ecdysteroids, and more specifically turkesterone, is this one, where the researchers concluded that, And I quote, "The above data indicate that phytoecdysteroids are of interest as potential agents capable of stimulating protein synthesis in the organism without violating the endocrine system functioning. The most active phytoecdysteroids may present an alternative to steroanabols." Now, in this study in particular, the researchers noted that there was roughly a 60% increase in muscle protein synthesis and growth when compared to control groups, which is pretty astounding. And what's more is that they used a human equivalent dose of roughly 65 milligrams, which demonstrates that there may be some level of anabolic activity with even lower doses of ecdysteroids, which again is extremely promising. However, the ultimate question here is, do we see the same effects in humans? And so in order to answer this question, let's go ahead and dive into some of the clinical research. Now, in this study, the researchers concluded that, and I quote, "Our results indicate that ecdysteroid supplementation does not affect body composition or training adaptations, nor do they influence the anabolic / catabolic hormone status or general markers of catabolism in resistance-trained males." And so in this study, the researchers actually found a big ol' nothing burger. And to be quite frank, the ecdysteroid group actually did worse in some parameters than the control group, most notably in lean body mass. Now, one of the more obvious questions to ask here is, well, what was the dosage that was used in this study? And this is where things kind of get a little weird. Early on in the paper, the researchers note that 200 milligrams of ecdysteroid was used in the experimental design. However, later on, they mentioned that they used only 30 milligrams with really no explanation as to why there's this discrepancy. However, it is worth noting that you would think that you would still see some type of level of effect at this dosage. However, there just really isn't any effect in this study whatsoever. And this is really the first study that indicates that ecdysteroids may not be as promising as we previously thought. Now, the only other clinical trial that we have is this one right here that somewhat contradicts the findings of the first clinical trial. And the researchers here concluded that, and I quote, "This project demonstrates the performance-enhancing effects of ecdysterone in humans. Thus, our results strongly suggest including ecdysteroid in class S1 anabolic agents." However, I'm really not sure that this conclusion is actually warranted, and here's why. There is another massive discrepancy in the dosage protocol. Early on in the study, it's pointed out that the subjects in this study are taking roughly 200 to 800 milligrams of ecdysteroid, but later on in the study, it's revealed that there's only 6 milligrams per capsule, equating to roughly only 12 milligrams to 48 milligrams per day in the test subjects. And the reason this is important is that it makes this study extremely comparable to the previous clinical trial that showed no results. And so at this point, you see completely divergent effects within the clinical research with really no explanation as to why this is happening. However, with all things considered, I do think there are three primary conclusions that we can draw from the research at this point. And the first one is that ecdysteroids do seem to be extremely potent anabolic agents in rodents. The second conclusion that we can draw is that the current clinical research seems to indicate that they are nowhere near as potent in humans at similar doses, but still may be effective. And the third conclusion that we can draw is that it is entirely possible that higher doses would be more promising in humans. Now, with this being established, let's go ahead and jump into some of the possible mechanisms of action that may be at play here. And to be quite frank, the mechanisms of action appear to be somewhat novel and are getting a ton of attention in the scientific community currently. And the mechanism here appears to be the stimulation of a very specific subset of estrogen receptors. Now, before we move on here, I do think it would be important for us to kind of get a general grasp of what estrogen signaling looks like in the body. And so in men specifically, estrogen is typically produced by the conversion of testosterone into estrogen by the enzyme aromatase. And once this conversion happens, this estrogen is then free to kind of flow throughout the rest of the body and bind to estrogen receptors and essentially carry out its biological effects. Now, one of the more important things to note here is that there are two very specific subsets of estrogen receptors, estrogen receptor alpha and estrogen receptor beta. Now, estrogen receptor alpha is typically present in breast tissue as well as bone tissue, where where when they are activated in these tissues, estrogen promotes the growth of these tissues. Now, the alpha subset of receptors is also present in the testicles and the hypothalamus, where when they are activated, they actually suppress the production of testosterone as well. And so when these receptors in men are activated, it promotes the growth of breast tissue and bone tissue, as well as suppressing the production of testosterone. Now, these receptors are also present in other tissues as well. However, this is kind of what is most relevant for our discussion today. Now, the beta subset of estrogen receptors is present primarily in the cardiovascular system, as well as bone, joints, and ligaments, where they promote the health of these tissues when activated. Now, one of the more important things to note here is that when the beta subset of receptors is activated, it actually suppresses the activity of the alpha subset, which means when the beta subset is activated, it promotes the health and growth of the cardiovascular system, as well as bones, ligaments, and joints, which is good, but it also suppresses the negative effects of the alpha subset, which is also good. So the long story short here is that if you are a man, you want to promote the stimulation of the beta subset of receptors while avoiding the stimulation of the alpha subset of receptors. Now, the good news here is that ecdysteroids seem to preferentially bind to the beta subset of receptors as opposed to the alpha subset of receptors, which means that theoretically, if ecdysteroids do get to relevant tissues within the body and are able to activate the beta subset of receptors, it's going to, one, improve muscle growth, improve joint health, as well as heart health, while at the same time suppressing the growth of breast tissue and the suppression of testosterone as well, which are all good things. And because of this, ecdysteroids, at least within the context of the research, is typically looked at as a health-promoting compound. Now, with all of this being said, I do think there are some very specific instances where ecdysteroid use may be most promising, and this would be in a group of people that are taking any type of anti-estrogenic compound, and these could include things like pharmaceutical SERMs or aromatase inhibitors, but it could also include things like Tungkat Ali and nicotine, which coincidentally also have extremely potent anti-estrogenic effects. Now, the reason that ecdysteroid use may be most applicable in these specific instances is that these compounds typically kind of suppress estrogen signaling in a universal fashion, which means that they, one, suppress alpha stimulation, which is good, but they also seem to suppress beta stimulation, which isn't necessarily that good. And so by adding ecdysteroids into the diet, you can essentially restore beta receptor stimulation without restoring alpha stimulation, which essentially means that you could theoretically restore positive estrogen signaling without restoring negative estrogen signaling. Now, this is all still theoretical at this point, but nonetheless, it does seem to be a fairly promising mechanism of action. Now, with everything considered, I do think it is safe to consider ecdysteroids a promising experimental compound, as well as just a general health-promoting compound. And what's more is that they also seem to be fairly non-toxic at pretty much any dose. Now, if you are looking for a quality supplement, I would highly recommend going over to Gorilla Mind. Derek over at More Plates, More Dates has created a fantastic formulation in order to increase bioavailability within the body. However, he tends to be sold out on his turkesterone and ecdysteroid supplements. And so if you can't find them there, there are a ton of other supplement companies that are out there now that are getting into this realm. And so it shouldn't be too difficult to find a quality supplement online. And if you are new to this conversation of natural hormone optimization, or you haven't got your testosterone tested yet, I would highly recommend it. It's a great starting point for most guys to just simply get quantitative data into their hands on where their hormones are at so they can implement a proper strategy to optimize their personal hormone profile. And so if you guys are interested in this, there is a link down in the description for a at-home blood test that you guys can use to test your hormones. So, but other than that, guys, I think that is it for this video. If you guys are interested in any of the free guides that I've got on my website, feel free to follow the link that's in the description down below. And if you have any questions or comments concerning this, I would be highly interested to hear you guys' results, any of you guys that are using this currently. But other than that, guys, I think I will see you guys next time.